Thank you, Father, for this wonderful opportunity to sit around your word, to celebrate this wonderful day, that we can remember the event where you gave your commandments, you gave your Torah to your people, and also the prophetic meaning regarding that, and also all the insights you're going to give us regarding our time frame, the prophetic time frame, and what we need to do to prepare for your coming. I ask you for being with us. Open up our hearts so we can understand and comprehend your word. And be with us. I ask it in the mighty name of Yeshua Mashiach. Amen. All right, so today we're going to continue with the controversial topic of Shavuot being celebrated in the middle of nowhere. So for those who probably don't follow the whole process, it's going to be difficult to understand. So I'm going to recap some things just to remind us as well of what it is about. And to just to add a bit more complexity, I'm going to overlay the double Torah portion on top of Shavuot. So these are the last two Torah portions, Mattot, Masa'ei, before they entered the land. And there's some commandments that Yahweh gave specifically for entering the land. And I think if we look at that prophetically, those commandments apply to us as well before we enter the promised land. Everything that happened historically is significant prophetically. And within our time frame, prophetically, it's significant for us to know what Yahweh told them and how we can apply that to our lives, or just to give us insight of things to understand it a bit better. So within this picture, I've got the broken tablets there, because this one is not the second set of tablets. There's still another Shavuot event coming. Now, let me just jump to the diagram. I'm going to move back. So we are currently in the fourth month, where the orange arrow is, and that's where they assembled around the mountain, and they waited for Moshe 40 days to come down. They lost their patience. They built a golden calf. They worshipped the golden calf. Moses came down. He saw that, got angry. He smashed the tablets, and 3,000 people died that day. So that's the event we're celebrating tonight. That is Omer 103, if you count it from first fruits. Previous events that happened was the 10 words that were spoken from the mountain. Prior to that was the cleansing. And prior to that, day 49-50 was basically themes of the wise virgins, the foolish virgins, and regarding the preparation, the 7 times 7, which is 49. And then 50 is basically Gematria that gave us insights on the warning of people just doing things and not really thinking about it. And still having a link back to Egypt, to the previous husband, and still have a relationship with worldly things or with their cultural idols that they still worship. So if you look at the menorah pattern, you see that Shavuot is actually right center in the middle. This was Yahweh's intent to give the tablets. And as we saw with previous Torah portions, it was a wobble. And then Yahweh wanted to take them out. Moses interceded. And this is basically a similar situation, but Yahweh didn't want to take them out. It was just another event where now there's additional plan that Yahweh put in place in order to repair and restore and then make it happen afterwards. So that's why the second set of commandments were given. It's not part of his original plan. It's because of man's sinfulness that there's another Shavuot topic coming towards the end of the feast cycle, which is roughly around the seventh month. So this was our previous study on Shavuot when we discussed the 10 words. And I summarized it, and basically Shavuot is not a specific festival. It's a time frame with different topics that's falling on different days of counting the Omer. So Shavuot never ends, because the final Shavuot will happen when King Mashiach teaches the Torah from the mountain. That's the perfect set of tablets. So we haven't yet, or we will not receive the perfect set of tablets. He will be the one who will give it to us. And that will be in the eighth millennium, the beginning of the eighth millennium. So the topic of Shavuot is not ending. It's like the book of Acts. You can keep on writing it. Shavuot is basically the whole book of Numbers. What we experience traveling through the wilderness, it's still the topics of Shavuot with little headlines as we travel in our preparation. So we're going to look at a few highlights within this Torah portion, because part of this Torah portion is to recap leaving Egypt and the whole storyline of entering. So it's similar to the story of what you tell the children at Passover. It's the same theme here. They have to recap, and this is now the overlaying the Torah portions with the theme of Shavuot. And the main theme that overlays is entering the promised land. And for the full set of tablets to be received, we need to enter the promised land first. So they both coincide with the same topic. So what I place on top there is Egypt, the wilderness, the Jordan, and the land. So that's the storyline, the recap of the whole story. And we are currently at the River Jordan within these two Torah portions. And they are about to cross the Jordan and enter the land. And there are commandments that's happened there. Prophetically, the Jordan, if you can remember, has to do with the great atonement, the great birth, the great tribulation, and the great harvest that's going to come in. All of those things are happening on the theme, prophetic theme of the Jordan. And as you enter in, you actually enter into the promised land, but in the wrong time zone. You step into the seventh millennium. If you're not part of the bride, you'll be in the land, but there's nothing. Everything is destroyed. And it's called the winepress. A 1,000-year period. And after that, and those that happens between two battles. The first one is Armageddon. Second one is Gog and Magog. And there are survivors who come out of the first battle. They step into the land, crossing the Jordan, into a wasteland. And then there's a second battle, Gog and Magog. And then they step into the land again, which is the eighth millennium. And then King Mashiach will teach the Torah after the city will come down. So a lot of things happening around Shavuot. And as I said, the middle branch is the most important branch. And Shavuot is the pinnacle of all the festivals, because Shavuot can only be fulfilled once all seven festivals has been fulfilled. And Shavuot is partially fulfilled throughout the themes that's progressively fulfilling Shavuot more and more. So Shavuot is not one thing. It's multiple things over a time period that still reach far beyond us up to the beginning of the eighth millennium. So that is just a bit of a recap on where we're at. The thing about Shavuot that links to first fruits, and those are the two festivals that are not pinpointed by a date in scripture. You have to count to get to them. And counting the Omer has got a specific function. Counting also means to recount or to remember, reflecting back. Because when you reflect back, it's part of your preparation process. So the whole Shavuot process that we go through is a cleansing process to prepare for the final Shavuot, where we see the king on the mountain. Any comments or questions? Clear as mud. Mm-hmm. I know it's a new concept for a lot of people to swallow, because they've been taught Shavuot is on this day, and that's it. But prophetically, it's hanging in the middle and you can't connect it to anything. It's a connector feast, yes. Yeah. It's connecting. And it's actually counting the Omer. That's what Shavuot is about, counting. And quite interesting, the book of Numbers is about numbers. It's about counting. All right. Good. All right. So now I step back into the previous Torah portion just to get a bit of a foundation to step into this new Torah portion. And what I read there was fascinating. It was about commandments or instructions for the sacrifices prior to entering the land. And it first talked about sacrifices, daily sacrifices. Then it talked about sacrifice for the Sabbath. Then it talked about sacrifices for the first month. Specifically mentions Passover, unleavened bread, and first fruits. And then it goes about sacrifice for the seventh month, which is trumpets, Yom Kippur, and Sukkot. And I didn't see Shavuot there. Where's Shavuot sacrifices? So that implies that Shavuot is a hidden feast. It is not yet relevant because it will only be fulfilled at the end. So basically just reading that confirmed to me what the assumptions I made is actually now confirmed, because it's still something that is hidden that need to be revealed after you fulfilled the seven festivals and partially the components of Shavuot. So just to recap the themes of the counting of the Omer, which is the themes of Shavuot. So Shavuot has been fulfilled from the first day of first fruits, and then walking up to day 49 is about the cleansing cycles, seven times seven, which is the preparation of the bride. Day 50 was the warning of the previous husband, which related to Egypt, sin and bondage. Day 61, when they arrived at the mountain, it was a call for holiness and to cleanse themselves with the washing of the water, which is symbolic, the washing of the word. So we see that on a spiritual sense for us, every year we enter into first fruits, we hit these themes, and we do that spiritual preparation process on a yearly cycle moving forward. So this is very relevant for our spiritual sanity or spiritual stability and foundational spiritual stability that we need to adhere to these themes. Day 63 was where Yahweh spoke the 10 words. It was darkness. It's similar to the wedding night where the bride became pregnant. And later on, we found in the Torah portion, we saw the symbolism of a wheat belly. Wheat harvest is a Shavuot. Now there's preparation of the pregnant bride to give birth. But what we see is that the birth is crossing the Jordan. So she's currently pregnant. And when they cross the Jordan, that's where she will basically spiritually give birth and then multiply within the land. The other thing I want to say about the 10 words, I made a comment this morning when I spoke to Letty. I said, when you gave your heart to Jesus or to Yeshua, you're actually not truly in covenant with him until you do the first Shavuot after that event, where the 10 words are spoken and you receive that, because that's the covenant that you make in that time frame. It's not about you did it on the 7th of February and that's now my, you know, spiritual birthday, whatever. No, it's the Shavuot of that year, because it's about Yahweh's Moedim. You get in sync with his Moedim, and that's where you commit your covenant with him. And if you're already in covenant, that's where you renew your covenant with him, reaffirm your covenant with him on a yearly basis. So we all have the same spiritual birthday. The first Shavuot after you came to faith, embracing Torah. That's your first real birthday as a spiritual reborn person, from my point of view. All right, day 103 was when Moses came back with the tablets, which was the fourth month, actually 28th of the fourth month, and the bride is now ready to prepare to give birth. That's also the day where the enemy came and proposed the building of the golden calf, and there was a lot of people died that day following man-made traditions, and the golden calf is a symbol of religion. So prophetically, we're still in the time of preparation until we see that final event after the city comes down and when Messiah Yeshua will teach the Torah. Shavuot, as I said previously, it's all about traveling through the wilderness. And symbolically, when we did the book of Numbers, we actually did the book of the wilderness, the desert, walking through the desert. Mm-hmm. And what we discovered there were all the enemies that we will find in the desert. And then we went through a portion where we discovered the enemies we will find in the land. And this Torah portion we're going to look at tonight is where Yahweh said, you need to clear out or get rid of those enemies in the land. Otherwise, they will be a prick in the eye and a thorn in your side. So in my mind, when I was a young Christian, I had the picture of the Jehovah Witnesses with the lion and the lamb, everyone will be beautiful and all that. What I read in the Torah is you cross the Jordan, there's enemies.
Yes.
There's still work to do. Mm-hmm. What's the go there? And we're going to put that in context to see who the animals actually apply to. So it's not going to be green grass, lion, lamb, and all everything's pretty and lovely. Because you actually step into the land in the time frame of the wine press. And that's where the enemies are. And that's what's applicable for entering the land, for those who step into the land who are not part of the bride. They will face these enemies. And as we saw with previous Torah portions within the book of Numbers, those enemies are within. They're either within you, or they're within the camp, or they're within the leadership. And that's where they will face them. And it's also confirmed in the book of Revelation where it says that Satan will be bound and then he will be released. So that's actually to prove that those people, you always accuse Satan of being evil, you're just as evil without him. You are the problem. And that's basically what's going to be evident for those people living then, because they will experience the same measure of evil that will be amongst them, which they generate themselves, because the evil is within. Satan's just stirring it, and it's using the evil within people against people, because the only power he's got is his tongue and
lies
to set up one person against one nation against another. That's what he does. He can only lie. He can't do anything else. He's got no power, no authority. It's been taken from him.
He's coming to death.
Yeah, he's got a lot of venom, but no teeth. Just slimy, venomy, gummy bite. All right, stepping back into last week's Torah portion, I just add something there that caught my eye looking at the tree. Now, this was the area of Shittim. And Shittim connects to the covenant, connects to the Ark of the Covenant, connects to Yahweh's covenant people. And what we saw there was there's also the enemy that is within, because the other side of the story was Baal Peor, Lord of the Gap, the idol that they worship, the Midianite women, the prostitution and worshiping their idols. That's the conflict that happens within the covenant people and the Lord of the Gap that influence the covenant people and how he got them to bow down to their idols through their own fleshiness. Now, in the context of that, there's a scripture in Isaiah 66:17, which I love to quote around kosher, because it talks about people will hide behind the tree and eat the abominable thing, which is the swine and also the mouse. I don't know who eats mice, but anyway, it's unclean things. I think that's the extreme of abominable things. And they hide behind the tree. And the tree, I think, they hide behind is the Shittim tree, because that's the tree that symbolized the covenant. It's supposed to provide the protection. Mm. And they stand and hide behind this covenant, and they still do the abominable things of the nations. Mm. And they think they have grace, and they bank on their grace. But Yahweh says, I will deal with you the same way as I deal with the people who do those abominable things. So you'll get the same judgment as the people who do the same things that you now do, even if you claim grace. Grace is not your little umbrella that you can hold up trying to avoid Yahweh's judgment.
But I also think it's necessary that you understand those you stand, just be careful that you do not fall. What is that scripture?
Yeah, you that stand, watch it that you don't fall.
Mm-hmm. Because we are all vulnerable. And
yeah. So we're not here to point the finger at people who eat swine and do all those things. Mm-hmm. It's their problem. We can help them if they want to learn. But you need to focus on your holiness. and contain your own fleshiness and your evil inside, because that can spring up and get you into trouble, just like we saw with Israel. What's really relevant this time with Shavuot is the broken tablets, and that links to last week's theme of the broken Vav, which is the broken Shalom. So the covenant of peace that we have is the covenant with a broken Vav or brokenness. And in the same way, the Torah is broken and we struggle to fully comprehend and understand Yahweh's word. And there's 30,000, probably 40,000 different pieces, which everybody's got their one little piece, and then they create their own religion. So within Christianity, there's over 40,000 different denominations because of this brokenness. And we need to support one another and bring the pieces together and stand on the foundation of the Torah in order to restore this brokenness. Similar to the set of tablets, it can only be restored after the final fulfillment of Shavuot that will happen when Messiah teaches the Torah from the mountain. After the city came down, will come down in the eighth millennium. So that is similar to the peace. And when that peace is restored, there will be no more war. Even the people outside the city will live in peace, because the peace will be restored when he returns. This one is about removing the Vav, and all the work that Mashiach did for us is found in Gematria of C70. I'm not going to go in there, but in the highlight, Shalom without the Vav, the work of Mashiach, means to be safe, to be in a covenant of peace, to be completed, to make good, to restore, and to give a reward. And this reward is basically entering into the land and inheriting the nations that will come to faith. They are your reward. All right, so let's start with this week's Torah portion. This is, let me just jump back to the beginning. So this Torah, two Torah portions deals with the vows made by women. We're not going to look at that. War against Midian, we're not going to look at that. Return for more, not going to look at that. Disposition of captives and booty, we're not going to look at that. The conquest and division of the Transjordan, we're going to look at that. That's the thorn in the side. That's the lots that are cast. Then Israel's journey from Egypt, revealed. We're going to look at that right now. And then instructions for the conquest of Canaan. Those are the instructions of sacrifices. We're also going to look at the instructions of entering the land. And that's basically our main focus for this Torah portion. That's the middle of all this list. I'm just jumping back. So Israel traveled for 40 years through the wilderness, and they made 42 stops, 42 encampments. In the first year, they had 14 encampments. The last year, they had 8 encampments, and during the 38 years, they had 20 encampments. Interesting about the 42 is that there are 42 words in the Shema, and there are 42 lines per page of an authentic Torah scroll. And they do it like that to symbolize the number of journeys which Israel made through the wilderness. So that is an interesting number. So being into the book of Numbers, I wanted to see what those words mean. So the 40 years, the Gematria of 40, has to do with the different stages. I just want to quickly recap before I jump into that. So the first stage is the first year where Yahweh established a covenant with his people and his plan and the promised land. The second stage is the 38 years that was the anomaly, which has to do with the 10 spies who came back with a false report, and then they end up cycling through the wilderness. So that has to do with cleansing cycles. The third stage was in the last year, and they traveled through the wilderness, and that's actually where they crossed the Jordan and started the cycle of the new beginnings. So the number 40 is the total duration of those three stages. Number 40 means deceit, to loathe, robbery, faint, to strive, to bind, to rope, lamp, to cover, to take away by force, to plunder, to hurt, to destroy, confusing by mingling, love, to patch, colored, band, company, mask, sailor, pledge, Yahweh sees, mystery, child, offering, milk, cheese, fat, cheerfulness. Now, when you look at those things, or when I look at these words, that random, and then I move them in a certain order, and I try to move some of them neutral, some of them, you know, it's a transition, and others are positive, and then I meditate on it. So it probably take me, to look at two numbers, it take me about an hour or two to meditate on it, to see what it means and how it links and relates. And being the first stage, you start off with the gematria of number one, Echad. It has to do with being connected to Yahweh. And the first stage is about leaving Egypt. So all of these meanings, you can connect with the leading Egypt themes, where they were robbed from their freedom. They worked for free. They were robbed from their wages, working for the Egyptians. They had strife. There was deceit. And they were basically in captivity. And then with Passover, the lamb was sacrificed, and the binding of the sacrifice happens with the rope, and the lamb's blood provides the covering. And then they took away, Yahweh took them away with force, and that force was the 10 plagues that came upon them. And they plundered the Egyptians. They basically take their spoil and their booty, or their payments, when they left. And then the Egyptians got hurt and they got destroyed as they crossed through the Red Sea. So all these meanings, you can basically connect through the storyline of Egypt. They left, they were colored. So that's some symbolism of a mixed multitude of nations. They were a band, a company. They made a pledge, which is the covenant. And the pledge is basically Mount Sinai. And then they are going to enter the land of milk, fat, cheese, which is the land of milk and honey. And they're going to have offspring there, which is crossing the Jordan, giving birth. And they will be cheerful and happy, because that's the promise that's been fulfilled. So within this number 40, you see from Egypt to after entering the promised land, with these little hints of these words connecting the dots. And this 40 years is basically capturing all of that. The number 42 has got a slight different meaning to it. It's got the meanings mole. Now, when you look at the mole, if you think about what's evident about a mole can't see. It's about blindness. Running sore. A running sore is a leper. He's got a running sore. So now you're a blind leper. You've got an ulcer. Ulcer means you're stressed out. Lacking. The world, you're in the world. Transient, to stir up, yonder. So you're longing basically for something beyond. Sudden terror, dreadful event. That's basically either a judgment or something that's happened. That caused calamity, dismay, trouble, to ruin, to fear, alarm, and flame. And then you see to bring, to carry, to lead. Elohim, Elohim is good. Stream, water, cause, age. Duration of life, Yahweh is glory. So from this we see the leprous state that Yahweh is taking man through, in a state of lack and of stress, and it's going to place them on the other side of the Jordan. And the Jordan is all about the terror, the sudden terror, the fear, the calamity, the dismay, that basically will be part of their restoration process. And then they will enter into Yahweh's goodness, where there's a stream of living water, which is eternal life, which is basically giving them a connection to Yahweh's glory. So number 42 has to do with the restoration of the fallen state into a glorious state, connecting man to Yahweh's glory. And number 40 is about leaving Egypt and entering the promised land. And both of those basically harmonize together and tell you a similar story. The next one is about stage one. The first year, they had 14 encampments. Number one means Aleph, also means ox strength, Echad, and Yahweh. Number 14 means pride, despised, hold in contempt, sacrifice, offering to cry, gift, sufficiency, enough, gold, spoil, booty, pot jar, basket, narrow gorge, steep valley, lifting up, hand stretched out. So you can already see the symbolism there. They took their booty, their gold, their spoil after the sacrifice of the Passover. They went into a narrow gorge and steep valley with the troops of Pharaoh behind them. Moses stretched out a hand and the Red Sea parted. Mm. And then they went to the place where the bramble bush were, which is Mount Sinai. And they basically could see the beloved king speaking the 10 words from Mount Sinai to them. So this is number 14, which is about the first stage, which is the covenant that he made with them after they left Egypt. The second stage is 38 years. That's where they cycled through because of the anomaly. Number 38 means profaners, commoners, unholy, worn out, rags, exile, to judge, to provoke, to rebuke, reproof, chastened of Elohim, to correct. Will of Elohim, departure, leave, basin, remove, uncover, value of vision, reveal, devotion, to study, vigor, increase, produce, fresh, and become new. Number 20 means desert, lofty illness, faint of heart, my humblings, fallout, brotherhood happen, destruction, calamity, animal sacrifice, to spin, which has to do with spinning in a circle or cycle, to become, to come to pass timely, to look, to see, perceive, seer, insight, prophesy, lovely, and his beloved. So from these two numbers, 38 years, they had 20 encampments. It's about the cycles, which they went through as a reproof, where Yahweh chastised them and correct them, gave them correction, so they can study and learn and unlearn the things of Egypt and their profaneness and their unholiness, so that they can become his beloved again and have the insights and start to see what Yahweh's plan is. So that's the idea of going through a wilderness experience. And I don't know if any of you had a wilderness experience in your life, mm-hmm. where you start off young person, full of ambition, stupid, make a mistake, and then you go into a cycle, and then Yahweh just works with you. And sometimes you go through bad situations, you get a few slaps by the world, and eventually you get out of it, and then Yahweh elevates you out of it. At the point where you start to see, where you start to learn, and then you get released from that cycle. So we all end up in that entrapment. And that's basically what we learned from these two numbers as well. Now, stage three is the final one, where they had 8 encampments. Number one, of course, strength, Echad, Yahweh. Number 8 means be willing, consent, desire, longing. At that time, entrance, coming in, entering, fearing, be anxious, be careful, be concerned, move gently to love. Now, what we see here is that the last year was also the 41. And the number 41 means border, to begin, make a new beginning, to plunder, to shave off, to be bold, which is another word for Korach, to cease, become foolish, to show wicked folly, burning coal, burning, to thrust down, to cast away, to cast out, branding scar, ram, be pleasant, strength, dear, willingness, mother, fertile, her own territory, to be joint and majesty of Elohim. So all these meanings, if you read Numbers 32, which is in this Torah portion, those numbers will, or the Gematria will make sense to you. Because they are now about to cross the Jordan. And then the spirit of Korach flared up again through the leaders of Simeon and Gad. And they said, no, we don't want to cross the border. We love this area here. It's beautiful, perfect for our cattle. We'll build houses here for our women and our children, and we'll inherit this land. We don't want to cross over. And then Yahweh was very angry at them, and Moses was very angry at them. And luckily they repented and said, okay, we'll still build the shelters or whatever, and the men will cross over with the other men, and we will go and sort out the enemies, which is said we need to sort out. So this is a picture of a new beginning. And what we read in the Gematria is fearing, be anxious, be careful, be concerned, and they move gently because they remembered the 10 spies. They knew there was giants in the land. And Yahweh said, you need to take care of that, otherwise there will be a thorn in your side. Now they're anxious. They don't want to go. We'd rather stick to this end because on that end there's giants. We don't want to cross over. Now, when you think about that in our setting where we are today, most people in the Western society are very wealthy compared to poor countries. We all live like kings. A lot of people don't want to cross over. They don't want to have anything to do with Yahweh or whatever, because this life is good enough. Yeah. I love it here. I don't want something else. I don't trust that. And that's basically where people are so comfortable that they do not want to embrace Yahweh's plan to cross over to a better place. And this is the situation we have in this world. That's why it's so difficult to preach the gospel to people who have everything. It's easy to preach the gospel to poor people in Africa, to poor people in India, wherever, because you provide their needs, and then you provide the gospel with that. So you have a connection. We have no connection now. And that's why it's so difficult. And I think that's the reason why Yahweh will bring the time of distress to take away those things in order for the people to want now to long to him, because those things aren't present anymore. They don't have those things anymore to rely on because they got comfortable. I think that was the same when in the book of Nehemiah, I think that time, the exiles could go back. And they said, no, no, we want to stay in Babylon. I think that's where that song of Boni M came from, by the rivers of Babylon. They wanted to stay there. They loved it there. They wrote their Babylonian Talmud there. They learned so much from the Babylonians. They are neighbors. They are family now. I don't want to go back and go build something. We already got everything built here. Why do I want to go? But it's not Yahweh's plan for you to make a home in Egypt, make a home in Babylon, or make a home on the wrong side of the Jordan. We need to cross over. And yes, it's going to be scary. Yes, we don't know what to expect. But he said, I will take care of your enemies. You don't have to do it. I'll do it for you. So we will be his witnesses of his glory, that he will show who he is. And we're currently in that situation we talk about tonight. We see all these things. What can they do to us? We can do this. We don't have to worry about a thing. He is going to overcome our enemies on our behalf. We don't have to worry. All we have to do is not fear and trust him. That's it. Those two things. And you'll be okay. So don't be like the stupid Simeonites and Gadites. Numbers 32 verse 5 to 7 says, wherefore said they, if we have found grace in your sight, so they're very polite and political, let this land be given unto your servants for a possession, and bring us not over the Jordan. And Moses said unto the children of Gad and to the children of Reuben, shall your brethren go to war, and shall you sit here? So all the other tribes were happy to make warfare, and these two decided they don't want to go. And therefore discourage you the heart for the children of Israel from going over the land which Yahweh has given them. So basically he's saying, if you do this, they will want to stay as well.
Yeah.
So you're going to start something, and that will have an effect. So we need to set the right example as well, and not be on the wrong side of the fence, setting the wrong example, and now people use you as an excuse not to do Yahweh's will. We can't give that to people who are sitting on the fence. We need to be active. We need to strive towards holiness, do the right thing, so those people who sit on the fence will want to follow in because they see your example. Right, so the next one is about the thorn in the side and the final Shavuot, numbers 33, 51 to 52 and 55. Speak unto the children of Israel and say unto them, when you have passed over the Jordan unto the land of Canaan, then you shall drive out all the inhabitants of the land from before you, and destroy all their pictures, destroy the molten images, and quite pluck down all their high places. But if you do not drive out the inhabitants from the land before you, then it shall be those whom you let remain shall be pricks in your eyes and thorns in your sides, and they shall harass you in the land where you dwell. Moreover, it shall be that I will do to you as I thought to do to them. So this means that they will harass you, they will be thorn in your side, prick in your eyes, and Yahweh will be against you as well. So you get a double whammy there. So you need to be obedient when Yahweh says you need to get rid of something. And I'd say, nah, I still want to do my Christmas. It's family time. It's so lovely. I don't do anything wrong if I do that. I do it all in love. No, don't do that. You need to get rid of the picture of Father Christmas. Cast down the sock, the big presents and all that crap and the tree. And get rid of the images of the idols within your culture that is still part of your upbringing. And you need to embrace Yahweh's festivals and not the pagan festivals. So all these instructions are basically for entering into the promised land. So the context is for us today. And we need to clean our homes. There's a DVD series from Clean Out House.
Tian Geldenice.
House cleaning or Max Kunyuice. Clean Out Your House. So he's got a brilliant DVD where he takes you through everything, specifically if you have children. He shows you all the things that are connected to all these nasty things. And it's got a lot of testimonies as well of people who actually witnessed when they remove those things. A lot of children are uneasy and hyper, ADD, ADD, whatever.
Yeah.
DDHDD with another age. Because of those things that they are exposed to. And then they just give them Ritalin and throw them another demonic little connection.
What is that man's name?
Tian Geldenice. Yeah, so we need to clean our house. Now the word pricks is the word sek, that means thorn. And it comes from the root word sakak, that means to screen over, to fence, to hedge, to cover oneself and to protect. Shakak's got the gematria of 340, that means Egyptian. Tramping place, to trample, decrease, bird of prey, to crush, to shatter, to break, polish, broth cooked from meat, drawn out, book, scribe, pure, nail, name, number, branch, watch, to watch over, line, my king, and my king is high, and quietness. And then there's also a few other negative words, bad, evil, wax, and colors and nations. So all these meanings are connected to what will happen during the time of crossing over, which is the trampling place, the disease and drawing out. And that will happen also during the seventh millennium, where these enemies will be pricks in your side. Now, have you ever wondered who will be in the mix? Who will enter the promised land in the seventh millennium? Mm-hmm. It's a mixed multitude, but who the, will they consist of? It's similar to Egypt. It's a great exodus. Mm-hmm. It's a mixed multitude. Who will enter into the promised land in the seventh millennium? It's not the bride, though. But who else are left?
The Christians.
Yes.
Jews.
I see a lion there. It's a lion, yeah, lion of Judah. That's Jews, yes. And they've got a book and a scribe. Scribe? They're the Sadducees.
Yeah.
They're the Karaites. They write the Torah scroll. So what they have that they take with them, they've got the Torah. They've got the people who are used to copy the Torah. They've got the Jews there. And they also have... the mixed colors, the nations who are from different religions. And there's also the Christians who do not, who did not embrace the Torah. If you read Revelation, it says that you need to have a witness of Yeshua, the Messiah, and his commandments. You need both, not one or the other. If you just have the Torah, you're going to be like the Jews. If you just have Yeshua, you're going to be like the Christians. You need to have both in order to have the right testimony and witness in order to be qualified as the bride.
And it's a scripture in your mind that says you have to be circumcised in the flesh and in the heart. So I think that alludes to, you know, Christian, Yeshua, and Jew. Thank you, Torah.
So where will the enemies come from in the seventh millennium? Because now we've read in this Torah portion, there will be enemies in the land. It's the seventh millennium. Satan is about where are the enemies coming from?
From within themselves.
From within the mixed multitude, consisting of those three groups. It's actually four groups. You get the Christians, you get the Jews, then you get the atheists, and you get all the other spiritual, yes, religious people who's got their different gods, all the isms, yes. And they will have their dynamics. But what we read, basically, towards the end of the seventh millennium, there will be two camps that will separate. One camp will follow the lion, one with the book and the scroll, and they will build this third temple. Because they've got...
Just like today's day,
yeah. And the Christians who will then embrace Torah will follow them as well. And then they will be inside the city.
Mm.
The other camps will be the ones will be Gog and Magog will come and be assembled from all four corners of the earth to go and make war against those inside the city, like we read two Torah portions back. And then the battle of Gog and Magog, where Yahweh will come and then burn the garments of the lepers on the outside. And the survivors inside the city and those on the outside, they will enter the eighth millennium, which we looked on as well. So the enemies that will be pricks in the sides of each other are the enemies that will stand up within that will cause the dynamics and the conflict for those people. So this passage is actually a message to those people will enter the promised land and not be part of the bride, will have those dynamics. But unfortunately, they won't adhere to this because the Christians, unfortunately, don't read this. All the other religions don't read it, and the Asians don't have a Bible. Best luck to the Torah observant ones. They will have an idea, but it's too late because the others will be the pricks in their sight. Sound a bit harsh there. So that's just something interesting if you put it into context. All right. This one was very interesting. Casting lots. I wanted to see what does lot mean. Because the land was not divided based on the number of people and the size of the tribes. Mm. It was led to chance. Casting a lot is Yahweh's way of intervening in making sure that his will is done and not man's will. Otherwise, there's infighting amongst the people. So through Yahweh's wisdom, and because he's in control of everything, he was in control of the lots as well. So I want to see what are the lots about. So the word lot is the word goral. That means lot, pebbles, stones, recompense, and vengeance. Now, vengeance and recompense can be seen in a positive way in the context of that's your land. So it's not a curse. It's something that's a blessing or a gift. Goral is first used in scripture in Leviticus 16 verse 8, where they cast the lots to decide the fate of the two goats on the Day of Atonement. So the one was set, sacrificed, the other one was sacrificed in a different way, pushed off a cliff. So there's a different vengeance or recompense in that regard. And it has to do with atonement. And atonement has to do with restoration and to deal with the leprous state of man. So the casting of lots we see is in relation to that as well. Goral is the gematria of 239. That means lot, stone, and iron. And this was a very interesting connection. It's only those words. Now, when you hear the word stone and iron, what do you think about?
Statues.
Yeah, melody. That's
yeah, the statue.
Yeah.
With iron and clay feet. Yes. That's one.
Yeah.
The other thing is, Yahweh said, when you build the altar, you shall not bring any iron
tool.
So mixing those two things, the one is pure, the other one is not. And the connection is interesting if you just think about that. And the judgment of mixing those things. So the clay feet actually represents an altar made by man's hands, not the altar built with stones that are untouched. That's religion. Or a system. Now this word is first found, the word iron, is first found in scripture in Genesis 4:22, in the context of just after Cain received his mark, and then it lists all his genealogy up to Lamech, who was the one who killed the man and was avenged 70 times 7. And after that, it says that Seth was born, the third son of Adam. So iron, and also one of the, I think it was the one just prior to Lamech, was the one who made weapons from iron. That's where the word iron, I think it's Cain Tubal or something. Someone like Cain. And I think the weapon was used by Lamech, and he killed someone by accident, by the weapon that his brother made. Maybe he made a gun and pointed the wrong way, didn't they? I didn't read the manual and shot someone.
I keep thinking about that whole Lamech incident, how he's talking to his wife, telling them that he killed a man, a young man who wounded him. It sounds to me like self-defense.
Yeah.
But I've only ever heard a preach that he's boasting about being worse than Cain was for what he'd done.
No. I think he was basically ignorant. It was done by accident, and the real cause was his brother who made the weapon. It was the weapon that was the issue that caused the incident.
Right.
Yeah, and that's why he was avenged 70 times 7. And if you see the word or the numbers 70 and 7, what do you think about cycles of 7? And the cleansing, he was avenged, so he had to go through a cleansing cycle. Just like a young man did something stupid, now he need to travel 40 years in the wilderness, you know, dealing with whatever Yahweh need to deal with, so he can learn wisdom and see what he need to see, so Yahweh then can use that for good. Now, The whole storyline, when I read this, sort of gave me an idea of the creation of man, then the fall of man, if you look at Cain's genealogy. And the fall of man led to the removal of man from the land, in this case, the Garden of Eden. And then after that, there was a future conflict, which was Adam's son, or two sons, one killed the other. And that also then came through Cain's sons, where he probably killed his brother, maybe. We don't know. Similar pattern. And all of that need atonement, if you link that back to the lots and the two goats. Because of the fall, they lost their land. There was future conflict. They need atonement. And that whole storyline tells us that from the Garden of Eden through the whole storyline of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Israel, going through the wilderness, and then the Jordan, prophetically, what is to come, and then the final atonement, Yeshua's sacrifice, and then entering back into the land, basically entering back into the Garden of Eden. So this whole storyline gives you that idea of restoration from a prophetic perspective. And we see the 70 times 7, which is also language used in Revelation, which is the seventh trumpet or the last trumpet that will cause the last cleansing cycle, which we now connect to the perfect set of commandments, which Moses brought down most probably at the end of the 6th month, the beginning of the 7th month, which is the Feast of Trumpets. So we see overlaying Shavuot with this whole storyline still confirm the same thing. And the final Shavuot is also the final coming of Mashiach at the blowing of the last trumpet. And thereafter, he will teach the Torah, bring the perfect set of commandments. And that is the great day of atonement that will happen. And the birth, where the final judgment or the great tribulation, that's where the birth or the born of birth of all the nations or all the new believers will come in. And that connects to the third son of Adam, Seth, that will be born. And that's basically a replacement or grace added to that terrible time that is coming. So it's all good news in the end. And this storyline basically focuses more on the commandments that are spoken. Now, have you ever thought about the scripture in Isaiah that says that Messiah will teach the Torah from the mountain? He speak the words, like the 10 words, but it also symbolizes the perfect set of tablets. So it's both of them in one that will happen at the end. The pinnacle of Shavuot is the 10 words connected with the 10 tablets, the perfect tablets, spoken and read from the mountain.
Until counting the Omer. Mm-hmm.
We're still counting the Omer.
It's a time frame. It's not a day. Mm-hmm.
And when I thought about that, I immediately think about Daniel. You count 1,260 days, 2,300 whatever days. It's all about counting the Omer right through the tribulation as well. Time, times, and half a time. That's counting the Omer. 3.5 years, that's counting the Omer. You're constantly counting.
Yeah.
And when you count, it's a theme of Shavuot that bring you to a new stage of fulfillment of Shavuot until you get the pinnacle of Shavuot where the two connect, the tablets and the words spoken at the same time. So that's our future. I've got a beautiful picture here for those who love Maker.
Well, not too much.
Now, this was something that just flooded into my mind. I was thinking the 4th month, and I actually got the breadcrumbs from the iron. So I Googled the verse for ruling with a rod of iron. That will link somewhere. And then I thought, oh, it's the 4th church. The 4th month, and the 4th church got a promise that they will receive a rod that they will rule the nations with and break the clay pots. Now, what we discovered previously from breaking a clay pot, can you remember what that was?
Is it about yourself being a broken vessel?
The broken vessel.
Shining your light.
We did it when we discussed leprosy. And we looked at how can it be possible for someone in a leprous state, next minute standing before the throne of Yahweh. And the connection was the same process, the priests were anointed by the ear and the thumb and the toe. That same ritual was given to the leper. And he was treated as a priest, and now he can enter into the presence from leper right to presence of Yahweh. And the criteria to make that happen is the broken vessel. That gives you the criteria to be translated from a leper into a priest. And those are the ones that you can't number to stand before the throne. They're all lepers that came to faith, that were born again during the great birth, the great tribulation, and the great day of atonement. And that's the connection. And the other verse that connect with that is in Revelation 20. And I saw thrones on which were seated those who had given authority to judge. And I saw the souls who had been beheaded because of the testimony about Yeshua, because of the word of Elohim, which is the Torah. You see the two witnesses, Yeshua and the Torah. And they had not worshipped the beast or the image, or not received the mark on their foreheads or their hands. They came to life and reigned with Messiah 1,000 years. And the rest of the dead did not come to life until the 1,000 years were ended. This is the first resurrection. Blessed are those who share in the first resurrection. The second death has no power over them. And they will be priests of Yahweh and of Messiah, and will reign with him 1,000 years. When the 1,000 years are over, Satan will be released from his prison. Now, this is interesting to see who will receive the rod of iron. What will they do with it? And when will they do that? So we already now discovered there will be nations on the earth during the 7th millennium. And these are the people who will rule those nations. And they will take their rods and beat them over the head until the pots break, until they get brokenness. And then the light can shine through, and they can be translated into from a leper into a priest. And they said they will be priests of Yahweh.
Okay.
And what we discussed.
That's grace.
Yeah, that's grace. So people have the chance during 1,000 years to become part of his priesthood, from leper to priest.
Wow.
And the key is brokenness. And the ones who are now helping those, they are the priesthood who rule them with the rod of iron. Where also have you seen the concept of a rod between the feet, or a scepter? That's a prophecy given to Judah.
Mm-hmm.
And you spoke about the Torah. Mm-hmm. Will be a scepter between your feet. That's the same language as the rod of iron. They will rule with the Torah, and the Torah will break them, shatter them, and their brokenness will elevate them from a leper into a priest. 7th millennium.
So how do you think that connects with the rod that Moses used to beat the rock?
No, that's his staff.
Oh, that was his staff.
Yeah.
You notice that it's always been this, what's the way of the other group of people. It's very clear from the scripture. The rest of the dead did not come to life until the 1,000 years were ended. So there's no chance of people just saying that they are now seated with Christ. I mean, a mansion in heaven. You know, everybody says when they die, present, absent from the world to be present with the Lord. They did not come to life.
No, you're in the realm of dead until the resurrection.
They stayed in the grave.
But there are two resurrections. First resurrection you're talking about here is the resurrection of the righteous. Second resurrection is the resurrection of the unrighteous.
That's right.
And the the risen dead. That's where the concept of zombies come from, I think. The unrighteous dead will be raised the same time Satan will be released from his prison. And they will go and gather the nations. And then Gog and Magog will include them fighting against the righteous living in the city.
But do you think it's going to be bodies or... I don't think it's physical bodies.
No, I think they will have hybrid bodies because they've been dead, so they
will
get...
I think it will be physical bodies. I mean, there are the unrighteous people that's been dead for many, many years.
No, they will have...
Not even both.
I think they will have a spiritual, physical body.
Yeah,
or
I think it's still like consciousness. What
it's that other dimensional body.
But they will be able to do something, just like Yeshua when he was resurrected. You can touch and feel him, but he can also walk through a wall.
Yeah.
So it's a spiritual hybrid
and,
body.
And UFOs that are physical, that they are physical, because they can leave parts on the earth, but they can also move through
mediums, it's just higher dimensional.
So Yahweh will give the unrighteous
bodies, yes,
as well.
A renewed body, yes.
But a weird one. Yeah.
Oh, they
will have to be able to make a distinction between
cut the fingers.
Yeah. So just go back to our fourth church. Don't know how to pronounce that. Terry, help me.
That's what?
Thyatira. So they are the fourth church, and their name means perfume, sacrifice of labor, hard working. And they were the ones who, it says here, by the rest of you, Thyatira, all you who hold on to Jezebel's teaching, who haven't learned what are called the deep things of Satan, I won't burden you with anything else. Just hold on what you have until I come. I have received authority from my Father, and I will give authority over the nations to everyone who wins the victory and continues to do what I want until the end. Those people will rule the nations with the iron scepter and shatter them like pottery. Now, so there was Jezebel who infiltrated the body of Messiah, and that Jezebel is a female Korah. It's also mixed in with Balaam, teaching them to whore after the spiritual idolatry. It's just similar to adultery, physical adultery. Jezebel infiltrated, and those who are not subject to Jezebel, and this is now the fourth church, it's the time of Shavuot's theme, prior to crossing the Jordan. That's where we are. There's Jezebel running around in the body of Messiah, and we who choose not to be part of her, we receive authority, and we can judge because we've got the scepter of iron, the Torah, and we can help to bring people to brokenness. And I've done a study on the book of Nehemiah, the rebuilding of the city of Jerusalem, and I've done some digging underneath the surface, and what I discovered there is that the priesthood, well, part of the bride, will come down during the 1,000 years and teach the people Torah who lived during the 1,000 years. So that's coming from that study, and that's how they will rule the nations. They will rule with the Torah, and they will come and interact with the people.
It's not big them to have all our own kingdom. And being a king and a queen.
Now you're a priest, like the Levites teach and facilitate festivals and do Torah cycles. That's how you rule them.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know, interesting. It's so interesting. You know, at the present moment, the leader or was leader of America, high politics was the Jezebel. Hillary Clinton.
As what?
She advocated all forms of debauchery, child sacrifice, and this thing fall into that church 100%. Period.
Oh my Lord. Yeah, look at that. The wording there. The deep things of Satan, of the occult.
Mm.
And she was into the occult, heavily into the occult.
Still is.
Yeah. Yeah. Now what overlays here, when you put our Shavuot within our counting of the Alma, within the time frame that we are prophetically, we're in the stage of golden calf worship, broken tablets and Jezebel running around, teaching people to worship the calf at the foot of the mountain, and they do not want to listen to the 10 words that's been spoken from the mountain. That's where we are now within our Shavuot that we celebrate tonight. And 3,000 people will die. Number three means covenants. A lot of covenant people will die spiritually because of this. Yeah, but we like the calf because it's got bling. We like Jezebel because she's so lovely, isn't she? All right, so that concludes our study. Any comments or questions?
Yeah, just, you know, something you hit on this earlier on. If Satan is the prince of the powers of the air and darkness, and he holds people in the underworld, you tell me those that have died, you know, the book talks about the two compartments, the righteous and the unrighteous. What you've said seems to fall into line with he can, at the end of time, mimic what Yahweh is doing and bring those people who are that evil to the back into the world to as a spiritual entity, a spiritual demon or anything. He has the power to do that, to infiltrate the rest of the people that have gone through the tribulation and come out, that in the millennium, when they're going to the millennium, to infiltrate those people.
Not to make war against.
To make war against Yahweh, because they're so angry, and Satan is so angry.
Yeah.
Nothing says he can't do that.
Yeah, no repentance.
No repentance at all.
Yeah. Yeah, they still keep their leprous garments, and their garments will be burnt, and they will be burnt with their garments. Mm-hmm. And then the next cycle will start, and whatever happens to them, Yahweh will take them through a cycle as well. So, yeah.
So, did you say when you receive this vision or revelation, in which... Were you telling me this morning, was he in a different, or did he see it in a different realm, or crystal dome, or?
No, you're mixing.
I'm not mixing it.
You're mixing things, no. But it's not going there. Okay. That's a bit complex. Yeah.
Okay.
No, but prophetically, it fits perfect. It fits our time frame. That's the scary part, isn't it? And that just highlights where we are currently. Politically, spiritually, in the body of Messiah, and we are at the border of the Jordan, ready to cross over. And a lot of people who are longing for the Messiah, Monte Judah said this, are the people who are in jail, people who are poor, people who are ill, and people who are suffer.
Yes.
They're looking forward to the coming Messiah. The rest of the people don't want to listen to it.
Just happy.
Yeah. Let me just sing my song and join my club and be happy and prosperous. Yeah. I don't want to study anything.
As I've said before, the pointers in terms of where we're at prophetically are overwhelming.
Mm-hmm.
Every direction you look.
Mm.
And yet people are in a state of self-denial.
Like moles, they're blind.
Blind, just... Yeah. It's like with this, I didn't sort of get into any discussion about whether he has any spiritual insight, but this guy who change the window on the van. Just saying how people are just asleep. He said it. He used that term. People are not awake, aware, not awake in regard to what's going on around them. He said it's just, you know. We weren't talking on a spiritual level, just on a normal level. Yeah. This guy can see.
Well,
he didn't talk about end times or anything, but he can see the times that we're in and the fact that people are just asleep. They're just, you know, totally brainwashed by the powers
controlling the media.
Media. Mm-hmm. Mm.
But also the sad thing is that the ones that are aware of what's going on but don't have Yahweh feel an overwhelming sense of dread and hopelessness and and then they desperation, they don't know what to do, so then they start thinking, well, we've got to overthrow the government, we have to get somebody else in leadership, we have we have to fight for our rights and all this sort of stuff.
They don't realize
it's not gonna work.
That's exactly what they want.
Circles are part of the evil side. Mm.
Yeah.
So the whole, you know, Biden's announcement, I don't know if you saw it, is the number one existential threat to America. White extremism.
Okay.
And who's the white extremists? Supporters of Donald Trump.
And they've got a 50-50 split over there, roughly.
Yeah. So he's going to, the great uniter, I'm going to unite the country. It's done the exact opposite. He's just drawing the line. You're either with me or you're against
them. He's labeling them.
If you're not with me, you're a white extremist and you're a threat to the whole of our society. And what that's doing is it's getting the guys that, the preppers and the whatever else, and the gun.
The doomsday preppers.
Yeah, getting them, well, and I can understand it. The country's being taken over. And it's not no different to the War of Independence, or the Civil War.
And the North and the South.
Yeah, there's no difference. What's happening now, it's just a matter of when, I think, that things start to really...
Because that goes over to other countries as well. It's not only happening...
It's a spiritual thing that sits behind it.
Because it's happening there, it happens everywhere else.
Now, what you said, that lady told you about the Aboriginals want to stand up against the government.
They are doing the same thing. They're standing up against.
They want to.
Yeah, they want to.
Why?
Apparently, they're having secret meetings and things like that. Because they also want to stand up against the ones.
Or the government.
This was 2 weeks ago.
Total fabrication. Andrew Bolt the other night was talking about, the stolen generation.
Yeah.
He said it's a complete fabrication. It wasn't like it. It wasn't as they have reported it.
Mm.
Aboriginal children weren't being stolen from their loving families. The ones who were taken out of the were taken for their protection, just as it's what's happening now. The same abuse that's happening in Aboriginal communities now, with sexual abuse, physical abuse, neglect and whatever else. These were the kids that they targeted were kids who were part Aboriginal, part white, because they were being
rejected
by their own communities. Yeah. So for their own protection, they removed them from places of danger and transferred them to missions where they were taken care of. And he talked about a mission in Croker Island in the Northern Territory, where this woman devoted her entire life to protecting and taking care of Aboriginal children in this situation, and the relationship that she still has with, or had, maybe she's dead now, but she still has with those children.
Yeah.
And he said, and yet we're being given this whole thing of, they were stolen, they were, abused and whatever else. So that they're just they're rewriting history.
More or less the same thing happened really in South Africa, with this whole apartheid thing that were happening there. Yes, they did let some of the darker people live in a different place, but they were looked after always.
Bought them schools.
They taught them, you know, they were trying to cultivate them and teach them how to look after the land and trying to raise it. So it was what in the history, what they portray as the apartheid was not really what was happening in South Africa. They were looked after. So when we look at, you know, what they call apartheid in Australia, for instance, I'm thinking, what? That never happened. It wasn't that bad.
You know, the whole thing about this is nation or rise against nation.
Yes, kingdom.
We are seeing that, unfortunately, right back in history, where people will rise against people and they will destroy one another. You know, a little while ago they said, give us a man. Whether he be God or whether he be the devil, we'll accept him. Do you remember that statement some time back?
Yeah.
I promise you, I'd rather have God than have the devil, because all this problem is around the devil. It's all around the devil. This is a case. This is, it's us.
And you've heard of this new Prime Minister of Israel, Naftali Bennett, who I initially thought was something really... But one of the things he's promising is to take the Temple Mount and rebuild the temple.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
It's getting closer and closer.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It's just,
you just said that like a week ago or something.
Yeah.
Really? Yeah.
Well, that's...
So I think within, he says within 3 years.
That's exciting.
You.
Within 3 years.
Well, you.
Going home to...
It's going to be a birth, mate. I'm going to give birth.
Yeah.
Very, very pregnant.
Yeah.
Feel the birth pains kicking. Boom.
To get that temple mount.
Sure.
Oh, and we're getting into current events now, but a ship blew up in Dubai.
What?
Did you hear that?
Oil tanker in Dubai.
Just
really?
Like
I heard it on the news.
Did a missile hit it?
Amir Safati, he was saying it's Iran. Upset because they've allied themselves with Israel.
Mm-hmm. So it was an Emirati tanker.
Yeah, and so they think that Iran is going after all of Israel's.
Things happening.
Oh, I'm glad we're down under. We're 5 years behind. 3.5 years gone by. What happened?
Oh, we had a ship blew up.
Well, the third world war started. What they
might be in the seventh millennium. Oh, okay.
Well, at least we can still laugh.
All right, so shall we close in prayer?
Mm-hmm.
We will do us the honors.
No, last time was me last time.
I hear you.
Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your goodness to us. We thank you for the revelations, and we just pray that we can apply what we learn to advance the kingdom, Father. We pray that your coming is quick, Father, in the name of Yeshua. Amen.
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 Sure can see, but that's true.